Hello everybody and welcome back to the next episode of Euro Truck Simulator 2. This is a Jack Wall Let's Play. And we are about to jump in and find out where we are. We've got $3,000 in the bank. We have 4 drivers and 4 trucks. And we have a load that's on the way to Budapest. So that's pretty good. We better start things up here, and we have good fuel, and we have our sleep done. We've got 11 hours of driving. Do it half past 2 in the afternoon. We could be half decent and let us out. We're not going to let us out. Go over to the other lane. Magnum. Not too bad. Nice. Full throttle here now. And that'll get us out. We've been there for a while, didn't it? We're on the road again. We're heading to Budapest. We have 25 tons, no we don't, we have 11 tons of fireworks, which is paying a ridiculous amount of money, $116,000. And we do have 45 hours with which to get there. And yeah, nothing too complicated here. We can send her on down the road. So I got back to the house today after a day's work and a busy old day in the office, usual carry on, but a good day. And there's a box that I've been not expecting until next week that's sitting on the sitting outside the door. The postman just drops stuff. I will have to leave or put something in front of our door so that he can drop stuff off, because he just drops it off on the patio. I live in a part of town where, you know, there aren't any problems with just leaving a package outside the door all day. It's a nice place that I live in, and yeah, that's kind of cool. There's not too much concern about it being pilfered or disappearing before I get home. But I still have an idea of putting some kind of a flower bed or something, a raised bed that the postman can drop stuff behind, just to have it out of sight anyway. But anyway, I get home and there's a box there. I wasn't expecting this until next week, like I said, because I'd only got it off of eBay. For the record, a big thank you out to a guy called Chris from the UK, from whom I bought and paid for a Falcon 4 from Microprose. Some of you will recognize the name, others will need it explained. It's a flight simulator based on the F-16 Falcon, and it's a really decent simulator. It's from way back when, in 1999, I think, is when it came out, and it's like gold dust. Well, it's not quite gold dust, but it's not common to find it easily. If you look for Falcon 4 on Amazon at the moment, and this is April now of 2014, the boxed version can sell for in excess of 100. Euro, and it's a game from all the way back then. I don't know how many were made and sold. Lots. It was a very popular game. but there's not so many that are available in the resale market. And there was an auction running for this game, and I came across it, and it wasn't even being the seller hadn't set up shipping outside of the UK, which was really disappointing to see. So I sent him a quick message saying, you know, is there any reason why you wouldn't be able to ship it to me? You know, I'd pay for the shipping, obviously, that's the rule. So I sent him a quick message, and he replied really quickly to tell me that yeah, he had opened it up for Austria for me, because that's where I'm living. So a big thanks to him. He'll unlikely to ever see this video, but if he does, his name is Chris, and Chris, cheers, man, appreciate it. Now I put my bids in, and I paid less than my maximum bid, just a little bit less than my maximum bid, so it was getting fairly close at the end. But overall, I think it was a nice deal. Job done, and hey ho, it arrived today. So it's sitting beside me here. I'm looking at it, and I shall be installing it and getting it updated. Actually, there's a benchmark Sims, or there's a mod team that have taken on the title, since, you know, the title is old, and I think Microprose isn't even around anymore. I don't think that they're a gaming company that's still in operation. They have this modding team have taken over the modding of the game and the updates, and they've, you know, apparently they've improved it across the board, graphically and everything else, the usual stuff, I suppose. I've yet to look into the details, but it's kind of cool to have the original game, even though the only thing that I need is the EXE from it to run. And I wanted to get it the right way, I suppose. I think there are some less than honest ways to get around the requirement. Less than honest, well, I suppose it's not the end of the world, given that the company doesn't exist anymore. It's arguably irrelevant whether the company exists or not. And I'm up for supporting the developers. I'm not really into getting the cheat and downloading the copy and running it. I think, particularly for active developers, you know, if the game is worth it, then it's worth the Big Mac meal, or maybe 10 of them, I suppose, the way the world has gone today. But it's, you know, it's something that if I'm going to use and get some enjoyment out of, and if it's a pretty good sim, then I don't have any difficulty in buying it. And I think this Falcon 4, I mean, this guy had everything. I mean, the original book is in there, obviously the CD with the software is in there, but the communications handbook, the Getting Started, there's a map of Korea North and South in there. There's even some printouts for some of the updates that came out in 1999 for the game. I did read through a little bit of it. I'm just sitting there with this stuff, and you know, the handbook itself is fairly sizable. It's a good hefty multi-hundred page book, I suppose. He wasn't joking when he was saying that the book is probably getting on for a kilogram. But it's kind of cool to have that old school stuff, to have it there, and to, I mean, I'll play it, I'll install it. I don't even need to install the whole game for the mod version, but I think I'm just going to go ahead and install it anyway, just for the hell of it. I'd not played Falcon 4 because I never had a computer that was really good enough to run it. Now, bear in mind that the minimum specifications we're asking for, I believe it's at a 166 megahertz processor, which is It's kind of crazy, really. It's a 486 computer or something of the day. Unbelievable. But today, with the updates that have been done on the mod team, with the work that they've done, I think that they're taking every advantage, probably still from a single core, but they're probably taking every advantage of the clock cycles to run the game and run the graphics. So you get all that much more out of it. And judging by some of the YouTube videos that are still active for Falcon 4, thanks again to this mod group BMS, they're pretty impressive. The learning curve seems to be pretty high. It's not something like this game, ETS2, which is, an arcade game with lots and lots of simulation-esque characteristics, but aside from the fact that it's just driving a truck, it doesn't penalize you very much for making mistakes, and in fact it annoys you with help a bit too much, if anything. This is at the other end of the scale in terms of a game playing experience. I've been playing quite a little bit of DCS, getting into the Sakai 25T ground attack aircraft. It's kind of the Russian equivalent of the Warthog, the A-10, and I guess on the British side, maybe the Tornado would be a ground attack capable aircraft. This is another addition to the flight sims, which, because I came across this BMS modding team and saw some of the fantastic work that they've done, I kind of fell into the idea of, let's see if we can go and get Falcon 4. And I found it quite difficult to find it. You can't get it new anywhere unless you're willing to spend a lot of money. But I'm quite happy that, Chris has got a few bob out of this, and he has it in mint condition. I mean, it's worth every penny that I paid. He had a really nice product there, and he's hopefully happy with the price that I've paid and how his auction went. So I have to say a big thanks to him again, because he's made me smile. It's kind of neat when people have a bit of care about, games. And I don't know if this was his originally. I think it was, because there's a few notes that are scribbled on one of the pages, which suggest to me that this was a book. This was a copy that he got, and those notes won't ever go anywhere, of course, but I think this was his copy, and he's obviously somebody who takes care of his property, and it's so nice to see such a perfect, I mean, there's not even a crease on there, a mark on the map, apart from the fold marks, and yeah, absolutely delighted, here I am. So I shall be getting into that and climbing up the curve. I'm going to stay flying the 25, Sukhoi 25 for a little while. Get myself a little bit more acquainted with that. There's quite a bit to do in there. There is the A-10 in the DCS world, which I'd like to fly a little bit of as well. But the F-16 has oft been a favorite aircraft of mine, even more so than the 14 Tomcat or the 15 Eagle or even the F-18 Hornet, although the Hornet and the Super Hornet now, but the Hornet as it was back when it first came into commission, was a close contender, really. But the F-16 had that something about it that just, I don't know, there's something about the F-16 that I guess people who think the F-15 is the best plane will feel about the F-15. I think the F-15 is probably the best plane, by the way. notwithstanding that, but there's something cool about the F-16 nevertheless, and you know, having a simulator that was so good, even early back in that relatively early day of computers, home computing, brought together then with the skill of a modding team with you know, modern techniques and the modern technology, it's really brought it back to life again. Not in a dissimilar way to how Team Fusion have done the very same for a much newer game in IL-2 Cliffs of Dover, which was a game that had all the technology at its feet, but unfortunately for whatever reason, the developer and the publisher weren't able to turn it into a commercial success, or even any measure of a successful product into the market until Team Fusion came along. And even then, I think Team Fusion are putting together the broken pieces rather than necessarily building the perfect, from the ground up, World War II warbird simulator. What Team Fusion have achieved is, quite simply, the best World War II warbird simulator that exists, hands down. I don't think there's anything that gets near it once you get into it. And there's all sorts of talk about the future World War II warbirds simulator. I will wait to see it, because you know, there's a lot of ground to be covered to get up with what Team Fusion have managed to turn the original IL-2 Cliffs of Dover into. It seems to me that BMS are doing the same thing. They're a group of guys that obviously love the title, flew the hell out of it, have skills in the code, possess the technology, possess the know-how, and more importantly, have the motivation to get into it and start, you know, start improving things. And if you look at some of the videos that are out on YouTube, just type in Falcon 4 BSM, or BMS, excuse me. There's a pilot, a US guy called Ralphie something, and it's outstanding. It's just, I mean, it's better than watching TV for me. Yeah, he has a number of videos, and they're just fantastic, just absolutely fantastic. He's not the only one. There's quite a few out there that are pretty good pilots. They've spent the time, they know their systems, and they fly with other guys, and it's a really professional kind of thing. I mean, it's not something you can plug into straight away. It would be something I would aspire to be honest with you. I don't know about it to achieve it. You never know. I think the amount of time these guys must have put into the game just to get as good as they are in it, given that it's a simulator as well, so it could be pretty unforgiving. And I don't think they're playing it with cheats turned on. It's impressive, frankly. And I'm at the early days with the flight sim, the modern fighter flight sims. I'm really still pretty immature with the IL-2 Sturmovik Cliffs of Dover flying, but over the course of many years to come, I foresee spending the time to get better and become more proficient with these aircraft, and probably taking advantage of the new stuff coming out as well. Hopefully I'm going to be taking advantage of updates that are being conducted by SES, new products that SES are coming out, American Truck Simulator, anybody. And hopefully the updates and the patches and the DLCs continue for quite a time to come. I would really look to the day when Euro Truck Simulator 3 is brought out with a big nod to the simulation-esque part of the community, where there's a configuration file or a configuration interface up front in the startup of the game, which gives you the option to, you know, to go full sim, gives you the option to go arcade, and gives you the option, which is what we're playing with Euro Truck Simulator 2, which is, you know, a decent balance of both. I think I'd be going full sim, and by full sim that would mean, you know, full sim everything. Make it difficult, make it hard, make it such that, you know, I've got to be driving for quite a while just to learn what I'm doing. I'm going to have to look up information to find out how to achieve things. You know, bring in the reality of the driving into the cab, and no more shortcuts, no more flags that are flashing to tell you where to park, or you know, no more easy yards that you can just drive into and turn around and reverse up and be done. All that kind of stuff. But until then, I think I'll be driving away on 2 here with the updates that have been provided and the improvements that are continually being made. Sequence of words I can't speak clearly. I think there's plenty of legs left in this game, even if it doesn't conform to the full sim that I guess not everybody would want, but I got a sneaky feeling there's quite a few there that would. Might be a poll question to try and get out if it hasn't been done already on the forum of SES, to get a split on, you know, hardcore simulation versus fun drive around, and see what the general response is. If there's quite a few people reading the topic and getting into it, maybe it might give some indication. I guess SES have to be able to take the risk to, you know, keep the game fresh, keep the franchise going, but not take such a risk that financially it doesn't pay off. And yeah, this has to be married, I suppose, against the amount of spend of resources developing the game in the first place. I think ETS2 has been a success, but the operative words here are has been a success. And maybe there are some royalties and derivatives that are still coming into the account. People are still buying the game. It's not, you know, the volumes will have dropped off, but maybe there's a nice steady flow of money in. Certainly there'll be a bump every time there's a decent DLC to put in. I think around a little while ago they did a $5 or €5 DLC of skin packs, which I didn't actually purchase that. But I think a lot of people did, just as a measure of support. I bought the Going East, of course, to make sure that was supported. I think skin packs at the time didn't really interest me, so I chose not to do that. But there will be DLCs coming up, I'm sure, in the future that I'll of course be buying. Keep the encouragement going and keep the motivation up. Anyway, here we are. We're 73,600 kilometers on the clock here, and we are making fairly decent progress now. We only have another couple of hours driving left. I would say we have somewhere in the region of less than 3. We have 3 hours and 23 also. Okay, we have a little bit over 3. We're 13 hours away from destination, so if we drive most of the 3 hours out, we should be able to make our delivery after our next rest. which is fairly achievable in this game because you don't have significant traffic problems or random accidents that close the road. And yeah, there is a penalty for being late, but it's not something that is so scary that people will try to avoid. Well, when I talk about full sim, by the way, I'm talking about route planning and the whole deal. I'm talking about having a GPS, but not really having any automated kind of, here's the route, just follow the red line. I'm talking about having to take out a map, take out a virtual ruler, and go and do some calculations. Look to see where are the fuel stations, because I know I can travel this distance with the fuel that I have, and I know that I'm going to need a fuel station once I get into this area, and so you pick your fuel stations, your rest areas. I know I can do this amount of driving within my 11 hours, so that's going to get me around this area. So then you have to identify what's the best option for your rest area and stay there. You know, all of these kind of functions, preparation for diversions or, excuse me, or reroutes, all that kind of stuff. I think that would make it. Of course you wouldn't be earning 116 grand for just driving to Budapest. The numbers would be much, much lower and much more realistic in those regards. And the time that you would have to deliver by would be a narrower window. And the penalties for being late and indeed being too early would be significant. Being too early, less so. Other than you would have to park and find a place to stay until the window to deliver was arrived. And maybe there would be an option where you could ask if you can deliver early. But the likelihood is that you mightn't be able to deliver early every time. That would possibly be a function in there, but it wouldn't be something that you could rely on. Perhaps you might have to do some resting. And also, the other aspect of it is that when you rest, you have some control over how long you rest. It's not just a default 11 hours rest that they would implement. The regulations for drivers in Europe into the game. So it would make some sense and not just be a default 11 hour rest window, you know, because, or 10 hours, whatever it is, because it's you know, if you were stuck for 3 hours and you were able to sleep for 3 hours, could you reset your logs and, you know, take advantage of those 3 hours when you're back on the road, and manage your driving time allowance appropriately, because, you know, go full sim. So you know you have your driving hours per week, you have your driving hours per month, and whatever. I don't actually know the ins and outs of the regulations there, but you know, make sure that rest times are calculated and followed, and actually have a tachometer programmed that is on a side file, which, you know, you have to do a tach, you have to do a way station maybe once in a while. Maybe you have to go through some truck checks where you have to drive over into a box and have your tach looked at once every so often, and pay a fine if everything is not in order on your tach, on your tachometer or whatever it's called. Those kinds of things are the aspects of what I'm talking about. It really is something that I would quite like, you know. for a lot of people, I'm sure they wouldn't. So leave this experience, leave this option in there, maybe with some improvements or some changes, but you don't have to go full sim and have that option for complete arcade, which is relatively easy because, you know, you just turn off the sleeping, you turn off the restrictions, and you can do what you like, and you can make your truck as cool as you like, and you can have all the fun that everybody enjoys, and that's all good. It's your game, after all. Have the ETS2 type of model for the casual simmer who enjoys the game but, you know, doesn't want to get into it to the extent that the full bore simmer would. You know, easy to say. Quite a big project probably to pull off. But do it as an add-on. Do it as an add-on for the cost of the game again. Like, seriously, I'll pay $50 for that functionality. You know? And have to have the base game in order to take advantage of it, so I've bought the game twice. I'll pay $100 for the game for that, yeah? No question. Because I'm going to drive it for years, and I'm going to get everything that... I'm going to get my $100 value out of it, that's for sure. Not because I'm just going to drive it because I spent $100. I'm going to spend $100 so that I can drive it, you know? So that certainly would be something I would be up for. And I have a sneaky feeling that I'm not alone. It might not be the record volumes that a AAA game would need to attract in order to, you know, be considered to be a AAA game. It might not be those kind of numbers. But I don't think it would be single-digit numbers. I think there would be thousands of people who would buy that level of a game add-on. Even with the graphics as they are here right now, as well. I think there are some fairly significant changes that would need to be built into the game, however, so I don't think that it's necessarily as simple as just doing a DLC with that functionality snapped on. I think it would... Yeah, it would most likely turn ETS2 into two games, which, you know, wouldn't be the same. They'd definitely have to fix these roads if they were going to do that. You know, because this is not sim-like at all. This is kind of annoying. It'd probably cost the $50, really. It would have to cost the $50 to warrant doing it, I suppose. And that would be only if there were, you know, enough resources to do it, because I don't think the volumes would be enough to warrant putting a whole development team into it. It just wouldn't... It really wouldn't pay off. American Truck Simulator is what would pay off, and that's why that's being done. And a dev team, you know, a small kind of maintenance team, you know, that would be quite an undertaking for a small group of people. It would take quite a while longer for it to be achieved. But maybe it would be achieved, you know? Getting tired. I know I'm getting tired. What is that? Is that a bridge? It is a bridge. The bridge over the river something. Was that a shooting star? I think it was. No, it wasn't. It was just a reflection. There'll be another one in a second. There it is. What is my driving window left? I've got 26 minutes with which to find somewhere to stop and rest my weary bones. Hopefully there's a place coming up just now. There's a fuel station coming up here. Or at least there is on that side, and there should be on my side as well, maybe a little further around. 500 meters, okay, cool. Let's stick on the old right signal blinker, and we will roll it in 200 meters. So this is perfect. This is going to get us down the road very, very nicely now. And it can mean that there is a good fighting chance of us completing the job when we get basically our rest over and get back in the truck in the next episode. which means a good chance of having a nice payday, making our bank balance decent again, and don't know if we'll quite be able to go and get another truck and driver on this, but we will be a lot of the way there to that goal. Right, that parks us up. Turn off that flashing light. Kill the engine. Handbrake is on. And that's going to be us here. Now we've gone up to 5 grand. We were 3. So we've made a bit of money, thanks to the other drivers, which is not bad. And there was 9 minutes left. And there's 8 hours of driving to complete, so we're golden. Okay, let's drop back to the main console. We're just going to have another very quick look at our drivers. Linka is doing $3.99 per day. Her log is showing that she's done one job. And she's heading back. I don't know why her log is not more than that, but it isn't. Gertruda. Gertruda's doing well. Look at that. She's had one makeup, but she's bringing in some good old dough there. Pressure tank to loads. 3,765 smackaroos. So that'll do. We'll take that. Hans. Hans had a bit of a mixed bag early on. He had lots of minuses up here. A couple of bigger minuses as well. But he's stabilizing better. It's annoying. Oh, not annoying. It's kind of not very realistic or immersive that they just, you know, they go from Vienna to a location and then back to Vienna and then out to a location and they yo-yo and not tour. And there's no way to influence or change that. But they're doing some decent mileage, 500 kilometer type of mileage, and that'll grow as their training grows, so that's not too bad. There's the Scania with 68,000 driven out, which is interesting. Why is it showing 68,000 driven? Because I inherited some extra mileage. That's strange now, but there's a reason for that, but I inherited some mileage when I changed truck. But it's surprising that it's showing 68 and not the 70-odd. The Hermides Benz is there, still not showing the white stripes for some reason. I don't know why that is, but there's a bit of dough on that. This is the Renault that Gertruda is driving, and this is the Iveco Stralis, which is a nice looking truck in its own right, depends. And that's on the road. Not an awful lot of mileage on that yet. Interesting. This is the garage. There's 4 out of 5 slots still. I'm in one of them, and the aim is to get these guys up to Joe. We're 97% for this week's productivity. So we're making 41 grand a day. So we're not doing too bad at all, really. Although we've had a pretty expensive month because we've bought some trucks, hired some drivers, and we're running that fuel. Okay. Well, that's it. Quick look at the diagnostics before we go. I've got 10% wheel damage, which is the big number, and then a little bit of maintenance on the rest. Nothing drastic there. So that's our numbers, that's our situation, and until the next time, catch you later. And as I usually sign off, go handy.